Hello everyone. Welcome to the I Am a Menopausal Equestrian podcast. Today's guest is Joanna Robbins of Esprit Libre Ekin. Joanna will be telling us about her track system livery here in France. Due to a terrible internet connection, the video recording melted our faces, so I made an executive decision to opt for the more traditional audio-only podcast, but edited to a montage of fabulous photographs taken by Joanna.
I have to ask something before we start the serious business of podcastness. What was that comment you made in Messenger about being on a Dutch gay dating show?
The new restaurant that's opened up, just waitressing. And I went in the other day and I was like, have we got any reservations for lunch? And she's like, oh, just the Dutch film crew. Bearing in mind, they're already being filmed for A New Life in the Sun, so I'm already being videoed way more than I'm entirely comfortable with. But, you know, A New Life in the Sun. One person shows up, he videos, they're normally lovely. This turns up and it's a four-man crew with three blokes being filmed for this Dutch dating show. So I'm serving them food and then they're taking it away from them and making me reserve it for new shots and things. It's all very uncomfortable for everyone involved as I'm putting their cold prawns down for the fourth time, at which point I realised I had got my nails were all painted seven different colours from my niece doing them and all chipped. I hadn't brushed my hair. I just looked such a mess. And then I played some video of my hands and all my chipped nail polish as I'm putting it. Turns out this dating show is the weirdest thing. So it's a guy that lives nearby who's opened a bed and breakfast, moved from wherever it is he was living to France, and now he's trying to find love. So they put two blokes in with him because he's gay, living at his B&B for a week at a time, and he dates both at once, decides if he likes them, and then presumably sends them packing if not. Yes. This can't be weirder, is what I was getting at.
No, this will be positively normal in comparison. Right then, Joanna, what is your business? What is it that you do? Tell me.
So at the moment, the main focus is Esprit Libre Equine, which is a holistic sort of track livery that was basically my dream in the UK was to build something for our horses that meant that their health issues were starting to be mitigated a bit because mum's horse has EMS and was really struggling with his weight. And she was on a quite conventional livery yard and was being told to stable him, and then he was getting fatter and she was being told to limit this and soak this, and it was just not working for him. And you feel so trapped on livery a lot of the time that you just can't do what you think is right for your animal. So I just couldn't do it, and it was an awkward one that mum sold her house and was in a position to buy, and it was just at the times that all the prices for anything with land skyrocketed kind of through COVID, coming out of COVID. So we couldn't afford land there, so we ended up here. And we wanted like two houses that were done, ready to move into, and like maybe 10 acres at the most. And somehow we ended up with 32 acres, a house and a barn that is nowhere near converted, even 18 months later. But nonetheless, but I finally got the track up and running. So I've got 1.2 kilometres thereabouts of track now, which I have put in every single blooming post around the outside and the inside islands, painstakingly with the post whacker by hand myself, and lost no weight, which seemed a little bit unfair. But yeah, it is beautiful. I'm so lucky with what we built, and it's vindicated everything I've ever felt I wanted to do with my horses, because Solomon is maintaining a beautiful weight, and it's a grass track, which I think a lot of people find a bit controversial and feel like tracks should be surfaced if you're going to do it. And that's not really what I wanted to do. I think the wrong grass is the devil. The wrong grass is a laminitis risk, and it's very worrying and all the rest of it. But what we have here is such diverse meadowland and such diverse hedging and brambles, and that it's not the same as just putting them on lush ground. So I want to keep as much of it as a grass track as possible, and I will surface areas just for hoof care and things, but that's not... Mostly I want it to be about movement, and they really use it all. Like if I sit down here for half an hour, I'll see them on every bit of it, which means they've got to be doing 10, 15 miles a day, I think, the amount I see them move around just while I'm here. And then, yeah, so it can support up to 8 horses. We finally got our first livery the other day, which was very, very exciting, because I think it's really scary to be the first one. Oh, duck. Sorry, genuinely, duck just flew over my head.
Like
I'm so Anyway, yeah, so it's hard when you're the first person going somewhere new, I think, to trust that somebody's really like knows what they're doing and things. And this is, and she's the perfect horse. She's been here less than 2 weeks, and I'm really all about like slow introductions. I do not like it to just get a new horse and throw it into a field with others. A yard I was on in the UK, they did that with a horse. It'd been at the yard before, but the other horses had changed in that time. So while it had been away, came back and it broke its leg on the first night. And it just, it was horrible to think, like just gut-wrenching. So I split her off, and the way I've designed the track means that I can make it into three smaller tracks very easily, with just a bit of temporary fencing. So I slowly made it a little bit bigger and a bit more fence line for them to share and that kind of thing over the first week. And then I let her in and I expected a little bit of squealing or something. She ambled over to them. They didn't even lift their heads from eating, and they were eating together in 2 minutes. So I was like, oh, all right then. I thought, that's not going to make a pretty running round video with you all making friends, is it?
Yeah, it's like that though, isn't it? Quite frequently, if I'm doing a field change, and generally speaking, everybody will be manic for the first couple of minutes. It's like, oh, we're in a new field. The very time you take your camera with you to film all that, it's like,
no, they just saunter in, stick their head down to eat, and that's that. It's been a lot of work. We dug a natural spring and stuff so that there's a bit of extra, like, easier access water down here for most of the year, and we've done a lot of work on it to make it what it is now. It's quite nice. When the horses first came, they did not like where we put them on the land. They said, no, this isn't good enough for us. So we let them loose over Christmas and let them pick where they wanted us to build it. And thank God we did, because they were so right. They knew much better than we did where it should be. I mean, we'd always thought this corner of the land would be good for it, but it stayed so dry. And I mean, like, our land's just not poached at all from a whole winter of them being up here.
And I'm assuming your perimeter fencing is absolutely brilliant.
Yes, the land we bought is all 6 foot security fence, 7 foot security fence around the entire 32 acres with 2-strand electric. So everyone always thinks we like keep dinosaurs or something in here.
Oh, wonderful. Jurassic Park track system.
It is so much better for him. I think they have to be well designed. I think a lot of people think you can just put a track around any old field and then it turns to a bog and their horses are miserable, and then they think track systems don't work. But I think it really is like a planning and innovation feat to get one that works as it's supposed to and the horses are completely relaxed and happy on. You have to be very lucky.
What kind of advice would you give somebody if they were setting up a track system?
Look at where your horses are happy in the field they're already in, or in the space they're already in, and don't rush into it. Let them tell you where they naturally sleep, where they run to if there's danger. Watch your horses for that, because I've left the spaces that they feel safest in quite big and open, and the spaces that they want to sleep in very big and open. And you've got to make it fun for them. They are going to work really hard on a track if you've designed it right. They're going to move a lot. And so you need to make that worth their while. If your hay goes in the same place every time, just in like a hay box or whatever, they'll still do what they do in a normal field and hang out and wait till you refill it. So here, sometimes they have ground nets, sometimes they have loose hay on the ground, sometimes they have it up on carabiners in the woods. Like, it's not consistent where it is. So they're they do forage a lot for it, and their water isn't always in the same location. They either have it off the spring or they have it in the buckets, and they're in different places. And yeah, just try and make it fun and interesting and as close to what they would do if they were just loose on a big open space as you can.
As near as possible to what they would be doing in the wild, because they would be searching for their next drink of water, and they would be searching for the next patch of grass or something to browse. What made you decide to run this as a business?
I think, I was agreeing in the UK for years with Hunt and Polo and all sorts of other things over the years, show jumping and stuff. And then for 7 years before I came here, I ran a dog walking business. So animals are kind of always going to be my thing. And I think I'm doing it for my horses and to build something big enough and meaningful enough they need a bigger herd as well. So it just works really well. But there will also be, I want to do dog daycare, and then we'll have like stay and play, because it, and I'm so secure that we'll put in like a secure dog paddock and do like, you know, like just general like off lead play sessions and things as well. It's just trying to find enough time to get all my ideas actually going.
That's the problem, isn't it? Sometimes you've got all the different ideas, but then you haven't got the either the time or the money or the know-how to change those ideas from just being ideas, but being an actual physical business.
But obviously, with us being here post-Brexit, we had to do entrepreneur visas. So that comes with its own load of fun. And it's not just my business to set up. My husband's an artist, very, very talented man, bless him, but has the attention span of a flea. Don't object, you know I'm right, sharp.
What kind Alex. Of art does he do?
So his business is Artisan Alex, with like dashes between art is Anne. He does everything. So the restaurant I said earlier that I work at a bit, he did all their branding, sort of their logo design and the window signage and some painting on the wall, like a mural. He's got another shop that he's doing hopefully soon as well. He has illustrated 7 or 8 children's books now.
Wow.
And he does some art markets and things with like his own stuff, and then he does like pet portrait commissions and stuff, like horses, dogs, that kind of thing as well. So
brilliant. So I'm assuming he will do all the branding for your livery yard.
Yeah, so he did, if you go on my social media, he's done my logo, and then I've got as my cover photo on Facebook, he's done a beautiful plan of the track so that you can see where all the paths go and things at the moment. And he updates it for me. So we're going to put in a sand pit and a field shelter and that kind of thing. And he'll update it to go with what we've done. But yeah, he's very good.
Brilliant.
But just very hard to keep on track.
Lots and lots of ideas for the future for your business.
Yeah, loads. Yes. Oh, God, yeah. More ideas than I know what to do with.
So what kinds of difficulties did you have when you were setting up your business?
Oh, God. What didn't I have? I think it's knowing where to advertise here is really hard, because the French don't seem to use social media in the same way the British do necessarily. So where my dog walking business in the UK, I did a lot of social media promotion. It's been harder here because that just doesn't seem to land as well. Okay. And also just the language. I didn't speak a word of French a year ago, so now it's like I've managed to pass my A1 and my A2, and then I'm working towards my B1 now, but it's been a steep learning curve, the language.
And for those people who don't live in France, would you like to explain what they are, please?
They're the government kind of sanctioned exams, DELF A1, DELF A2. And for your visas now for entrepreneurs, you have to have a certain level to be able to stay after your first year. So they do a test at the Office for Immigration.
Oh, wow.
And depending on whether you get a nice person or a not so nice person on that day, they can assign you up to 600 hours of mandatory lessons. And the only way to circumvent having to do the mandatory lessons, is to do these exams. So we did ours at Bergerac, and to be honest, I'm really glad we did, because it made me work harder. Another one of my big difficulties here is that when they changed everything to online, the government's like the what you register your business category as, they dropped loads of categories, and one of them was for like livery. So first time they registered me as a stud breeding, which I obviously am not. So I got that changed because I wanted to be under commerce rather than MSA, which was what I would have been under. And then commerce doesn't have a category, so they put me as a poultry castrator. I mean,
okay.
I wouldn't know where to start castrating poultry, so don't ask me to do it. But apparently, that on paper, that's what I do now.
That's absolutely bonkers. No, I've got no idea how you castrate a chicken either. Well, a cockerel, I suppose. Testicles up the cloaca, perhaps? No idea. But yeah, yes, sounds like you have to be really organised. I'm not very good at being organised. I'm away with the fairies most of the time. I'm going to do it. I'm going to become organised.
No, don't do it. Don't say you're going to get organised, because then when you don't, it'll be a disappointment to yourself. Just surprise yourself with organisation. Let it sneak up on you that you've suddenly got professional with this and it's all going very smoothly.
The way that I'm thinking is that doing it anyway, and I thought, well, that could actually be an inspiration to somebody else who wants to do it and also doesn't know what they're doing, and they might be waiting until that everything's perfect before starting, and I could be like the inspiration of, nah, fuck it, just do it. Oh, swearing. Yeah, okay. I got a foul mouth as well, and I keep remind myself that not everybody swears.
I think I've done very well. We've been speaking for like half an hour and I haven't sworn once.
Editing this, I can just have a little... Now then, the whole point behind this podcast is to talk to horsey business people about the struggles behind working. I want to kind of set up a business and I want to know what kinds of things horsey business people struggling to find that would help them either in setting up business or in continuing to run a business. What kind of thing do you feel that you need that currently isn't available?
Good question. Some kind of magical marketing fairy. Somebody that like corrals the other horsey folk towards you.
Yes. Kind of somebody who can funnel the traffic in your direction.
Yes, that would help.
And yes, this is precisely what I'm learning at the moment.
But like Frenches for you a little bit in terms of being able to quickly spot mistakes and things you've put out there. Like, because for me, like I'll post in French, and thanks to DeepL, it's not completely illegible, but I frequently make stupid errors. And after about the fifth time I've done it, some nice follower will message me and be like, do you know that you keep doing this? And I'm like, no, because no one told me.
Yes. And I'll give you an example. I'll give you an example of this. A friend of mine, now this is going back 20 years ago now, and we moved to France at about the same time. And she was a chimney sweep. And she was getting the pronunciation wrong for chimney sweep and was merrily going around telling everybody that she was a prostitute.
Excellent. I loved that she was announcing that with such... I hope she didn't change when she realised.
Well, her husband, who at the time spoke perfect French, thought it was hilarious and didn't correct her and let her carry on doing this for a good month or so.
What an ass. I love that.
The divorced man.
Yes. And it would just be nice to have someone that jumped in and stopped you looking like quite such an idiot every now and then. Just occasionally just bailed you out of that stupid.
Yes. I think I need one of those. What name would we give a person like that apart from fairy godmother?
Yes. Business fairy godmother. Can we have one of those, please? I think we all need one.
Definitely.
But yeah, aside from that, I have to say that, like, generally speaking, since I've been here, people are super friendly, they're super helpful, it's a nice community we live in, we're very lucky.
And generally speaking, if you're a nice person, people will respond positively to you anyway. So it tends to be, if you listen to different people's experiences of living in any country, it's not just France, not just England, and if they're a nice person, they're giving out that nice energy anyway, so people are responding back. And if they're not a nice person and they're giving out that bad vibe, then they're going to be kind of getting that back in return. There was a story I heard on fairly recently about a man was walking down the beach and somebody said, I've only just moved here. What are the people like in this area? And he said, well, what are the people like in the area you come from? And they said, oh, they're awful. And his answer was, they'll be the same here. And then he went a bit further down the beach and he met another person who said, I've just moved here. What are the people like here? And he said, well, what were they like where you were before? Oh, they were wonderful. They were so helpful. Oh, yes, they're exactly the same here.
Yeah.
And I've just remembered who it was. It was Wayne Dwyer. And it was a video I saw of his not so long back.
Yes, I see that, but I also think that it does make a difference here that people have more space. When I go back to England now, everything's so intensely in each other's space. You feel so claustrophobic with it when you're used to what we have here. And so people keep their heads down and they don't want to impose upon other people's territory effectively. Whereas here, everywhere you go, everyone you pass in the street will say hello to you. Everyone, all your neighbours will be polite and things. Whereas in the UK, there was neighbours that I lived next to for 5-6 years, and I don't think I ever exchanged a word with them.
Really?
And not because I wasn't. I talk to everyone. I hello to everyone. But I think people just don't. They don't feel confident to engage when they're so sort of sardines in a tin.
There was a woman that I used to pass every single morning for about 5 years on the canal bank. And every single morning I would say, morning! And every single morning she would put her head down. And I could see her as she'd be walking towards me. She'd start to put her head down and she'd start to scuttle past me. And every single morning I'd be, morning! And I can't remember how long it took, 18 months, 2 years or whatever it was. She eventually said, morning! And I went, yes!
Love it.
Positive bullying.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with a bit of positive bullying. Yes, yeah, sorry, you had questions.
No, I'm making it up as I go along. We've kind of worked through with what you were saying about, you know, the business fairy godmother and the marketing fairy. Those are two ideas that I'd already had for my business. So it's really nice to hear that is actually what people do need. And when I was speaking to Nikki and to Ruth, they both in a slightly different way said exactly the same thing, which gives me confidence that I am actually going down the right path with how I can help people. And as I was saying with Nikki, as long as I am one step ahead of the person I'm helping, I can be researching just that one step ahead. So if I'm permanently one step ahead of helping people, then I'm going to be doing the correct thing. And not just people in France. And I know that you are the third person. I know you're the third person in a row who happens to live in France. But you know, there's people who are listening to the podcast who are in the UK, America, Canada. There's a lady from Brazil as well who tunes in and has been and is a member of the group. So it'd be interesting to see if people outside of France are also looking for the same kind of help. But marketing is definitely what I'm learning marketing for me, because I was I need to market my book, which is nearly finished, and my app, which is also nearly finished. And I was practicing on Ruth with Exodus, her book. And that made me realize how much I didn't know. So now I'm learning marketing, and I'm thinking, well, if I'm learning it for me and if it's a skill that I'm gaining for me, it makes sense to then also help other people. And to turn that into a business too.
I think some of us have brains like that. Like for me and my mum are both the same, that it doesn't really matter if we know something about the subject. We generally have the kind of brain that can find the answer to it. I'm always thinking 12 things at a time. I'm always like flitting. And I tend to see problems in a way that I can solve them with relative ease, better with other people's than my own, aren't we all?
Yes, I know, that's so weird, isn't it? And I'm more motivated to helping other people than helping ourselves. Seems to be a thing.
You either have that kind of like that kind of problem solving brain or you don't. I think it's not really something you can teach yourself.
Yes, no, it's very true though. It's problem solving. It is a certain brain set. I don't suppose you're autistic, are you, or on the spectrum?
Oh, yes. How did you know?
Well, it's just like gay people, we recognise each other.
We don't need a fancy flag, we just see it.
Yeah.
Yeah, so autistic 5-year-old twins, ADHD husband, and I'm autistic. It is a hell of a party at our house.
Yeah, I can imagine. Much prefer being autistic. Much prefer. I think we have a much more interesting way of life. Okay, so communicating with the neurotypical can sometimes get a little bit sort of hair-raising. And having a literal brain as well can be great in some respects and awful in others. Like Manu said to me just a couple of days ago, Ellie, can you rake up all the hay? And this is the, I deliberately, can you rake up all the hay that is outside the front of the barn? And then 15 minutes later, he comes back and he said, are you still doing it? And I said, well, yes. And he said, I didn't mean all, I meant get the worst of it. And I'm thinking, you said all.
Why didn't you say get the worst of it? Mine is just like, it's the not reading people's emotions well that does me in, because my mother, God bless her, is one of those people who just seems upset with you even when she's not. She's quite a tense, anxious person as a human. And then she goes a little bit high-pitched if she's not understood, which again, not... But I'll be like, what's wrong? And she'll be like, there's nothing wrong. And I just don't believe her, because she's just like... All of my social cues and learned responses to like, when I've seen that face before, it means this.
Yes.
So you can't pull that face and not actually have that emotion in my world. That doesn't work. It just does not work for me. Women with autism, that's a whole other level of support that I need in a business.
Well, yes. Women in autism in business. Now that's something to do, isn't it? Women with autism in the equine industry in business.
Yeah.
Now, you see, my course says the more niche you can get, or it's an American course, so they keep saying niche, which makes me want to punch them. It's niche. They say the more niche you can get, the more successful you will be. Now, you can't get much more niche, can you, than autistic women in business in the equine industry?
I think... Yeah, that sounds good to me, because I think there's a lot of us. I think, like, it's a birds of a feather flock together thing, isn't it? It's
yes, and autistic people tend to be drawn to animals.
And I won't name her, because I don't know how perfect she is with her autism actually. But I had a very good trimmer in the UK who I absolutely adore. She is. And always will be one of my very close friends now. But within about twice of her coming to my horse, I was like you just did to me, are you autistic by any chance? And she was like, yes. And I'm like, but she's, her special interest in life, her obsession is hooves, and it just works for her.
Yes. And she's probably more knowledgeable than any other trimmer, because she will be obsessively researching everything, because that's what we do, don't we?
Yes,
we want to know everything about whatever it is.
Once you like something, you have to know everything about it.
Your track system. So you've got one new client. How many clients are you hoping to have in totality?
Ideally six. I've got space that I could maybe go to eight, but I think six for my sanity. And then I have space as well for horses from one household to come as like holiday livery for a week or 2 weeks over summer. So April to October time.
Oh, that's a good idea.
But that would be on a separate part of land to the track. So there'd be no crossover between our permanent residents and our temporary coming and going horses. Always trust an insane autistic person to look after your animals, because while we are mental, we are really diligent and we are obsessed with making everything right. And
exactly,
if you need your horse looking after while you're on holiday, or you need your horse looking after more permanently, send them here. I have space. And you're going to become a business fairy godmother and save us all from ourselves. Perfect.
Yes. Excellent. We have a plan, and it is coming.
We have a plan.
Yes. Now then, before you go, what you need to do now is you need to tell us where you are. Because if somebody is watching this and wants to actually get in touch with you, we need to know where you are and what your contact details are. Now, I will be putting a link in the comments. So people will have a clickable link. When I figure out how to do it on the screen, I will do so. But for the moment, I'm putting clickable links in the comments.
I am near Chateau Chevy, so in Santa Rita La Peche, 87380. So it'll be my Facebook page. It's got my email address. Not that I ever check my email, sorry. If you've ever emailed me and I've not replied to you, sorry. Then... yeah, but yes, I do reply to Facebook messages and WhatsApps and texts and all that kind of thing, and it's all on my Facebook page.
Excellent. Right then, well, thank you ever so much for coming and talking to me.
It's been fun. Hi, Bonnie. Hi. Hey, you're beautiful. You are so beautiful.
Thank you so much. That's so sweet.
I'm joking. Tony wasn't talking about the pony.
She's talking about the Shetland pony, not me.
No. I don't know how to leave. I'm stuck in here.
Thank you.
Bye.